two suitcases, life in the backpack, new destination, full tank and a road map. My DJ, my best friend by my side, windows rolled down as I put the car in drive.
I don't know where we'll go, just know that we've got miles. We've got miles, miles to go.
Hi, I'm Dee Perry, and I'm joined by my co-host Aaron Spears. Hey, Aaron.
Morning, Dee.
And we are here for another edition of CIFF Speaks, the official podcast of the Cleveland International Film Festival. And we're joined today by the director, cinematographer, and editor of a film called Represent. Welcome to Hillary Bachelder. Hillary, thank you for being with us.
Thanks for having me. It's lovely to be in this virtual space with you guys.
I like that. I feel closer already. So what would you say about Represent if you were introducing it in front of an audience at the film festival?
Sure. So Represent is a heartfelt portrait of three women running for local office in their Midwest communities. So in the film, we get to meet Maya Jones, who's a 22-year-old running for mayor of Detroit, Bryn Bird, who's a produce farmer in Granville, Ohio, running for township trustee, and Julie Cho, a Republican Korean immigrant running for state representative in Illinois. And with the film, we're trying to challenge viewers to consider sort of complicated and passionate candidates on both sides of the aisle. So we hope that audiences can watch and meet them with an open mind.
You are, Hillary, a former director of production at Cartemquin Films, and you worked in various capacities on several award-winning productions. So what's Cartemquin's connection to your current film, Represent?
Yeah, Cartemquin is a social issue kind of documentary production company based in Chicago, which is where I am. And yeah, I was on staff for a number of years, and they're kind of the folks that I turned to kind of the second that I had this idea for the film. And they've been a co-production partner along the way and have provided a lot of creative guidance and mentorship and kind of strategic guidance and mentorship over the last 3 years. Yeah.
And a previous film of yours called Embodies explored three women's complicated relationships with the human body. And as we mentioned, your most recent explores three women's complicated relationships with the political body. I was curious if there's something about trios that appeals to you as a storyteller.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's funny. I really got a niche for myself. I actually really have always loved the opportunity to kind of find juxtapositions. I think it's maybe the editor in me, but I think there's a lot of potential to find and draw conclusions about the universality of certain experiences that you can't do when you're following just one person. And I think in this case, in the film, you know, it's powerful to see one woman experience something, but when we can jump across communities and travel hundreds of miles and see another woman experiencing the exact same thing, you know, it just provides an opportunity to create kind of a statement around that. And on the flip side, I always think it's interesting to find kind of the contrasting experiences. Again, mm-hmm. with a film about women running for political office, it's like, you might see one woman struggle with something that another does not. And there's conclusions to be drawn from that as well.
Hillary, I wanted to ask, since you're kind of pulling triple duty here, cinematographer, editor, director, are there moments when you're behind the camera and directing that you're like, oh, I got to keep that scene? Or like, how do you kind of keep that all separate in production? Or is it just sort of all there all the time for you, wearing all three hats?
Yeah, I mean, you can definitely go a little nuts trying to wear all three hats all at once. Yeah, it's important to have a team around you who can help weigh in on things. And I think just as important, there are those moments in production that you experience really powerfully and impactfully in the moment where you're like, oh, I feel the energy in this room. I know I got the perfect shot for it. And you fall in love with it in the moment. And those are the moments that, you know, they always say in editing, you have to kill your darlings or whatever it is. Yeah. I think it's especially hard when it's like you sort of conceived the darlings in the moment and you've been holding on to them for the entirety of kind of a production and post-production process. So, yeah, I mean, it gets tricky in the edit, but it's important to have smart people in the room with you who can help you let go and reframe and say, yeah, what you saw in that originally maybe isn't what is translating now in the edit.
Sure.
Yeah, I wondered about that, if there were people surrounding you as you were making those decisions, or if you were only listening to your own voice, and it sounds like no.
Yeah, I worked with a great team of kind of, we had a consulting editor, some additional editors, and again, the folks at Cartemquin, Gordon Quinn is the artistic director and the founder of Cartemquin, and kind of a documentary OG, if you will. So Gordon and some of the other folks at Cartemquin weighed in quite a bit. So that was extremely important throughout the editorial process.
So how did you go about finding your three subjects, Maya, Julie, and Bryn?
So I knew that I wanted to make the film kind of pretty quickly after the 2016 presidential election. And the first thing I did, which sounds so basic, but like I set a Google alert for women in politics. Sure. And that was, and Maya Jones was like probably the first Google alert that ever popped up, because she announced she was going to run for mayor of Detroit in January, I think, of 2017. And so, as you can imagine, there was a bit of local press about her. And so I got like a little ping in my inbox and was like, well, this just seems worth exploring. So kind of reached out to her from there and ended up filming. And it was pretty obvious that that she had an incredible story. And then Bryn, I found actually because I was taking part in all of these events that were hosted by organizations that support and train women running for office. And I found one in Wisconsin that was specifically to support women in farming and agriculture who are interested in running for office. So it was a room full of women farmers who were all thinking about, yeah, running for local office. And I went to that event and I kind of fell in love with everyone there. And none of them were quite ready to jump into their races, but I was like, can you just please put the feelers out to anyone else you might know who I could connect with? And it got passed on until Bryn actually reached out to me and said, like, I think I'm the person you're looking for, which is a great way to connect with someone. And then Julie, I actually was at that point, I knew that we were looking for a Republican candidate as well. And so I started going to some like local Republican forums around Chicago and the suburbs. And so ended up connecting to her just, yeah, through forums and through other candidates running. So unfortunately, there weren't that many first time female Republican candidates in Illinois at the time. So, yeah, so it was kind of easy to get directed to Julie in that sense.
And she was interesting to me because of the way she was framing herself in trying to sway heavily Democratic areas that she was going to. If you don't like the Republican Party, then why not vote for me and do something different?
Yeah.
Was it a struggle to find those three? Or did you consider other women and decide, no, this is the core that I want?
It was a struggle to narrow it down. I probably did phone interviews or some in-person interviews with 30 or 40 different candidates, I think.
Oh, wow.
Between 2017 and 2018. And I might be a sucker, but like I fell in love with all of them. I was like, oh my God, you live in Iowa and like an old converted windmill and you're going to run for treasurer.
Oh, wow.
Like, this is so cool. It was really easy for me to get caught up. And everyone was really doing it kind of that I talked to anyways for the right reasons. It was all women who were, sure, really, really passionate and excited and brought really interesting experience. It was a challenge to narrow it down. I would have made a 10-part series, maybe, if I could have.
That's not a bad thing.
I was just thinking, as much as I enjoyed your film, I was like, now I kind of want the making of your film documentary on top of it.
Right. Yeah. And speaking of that, the opening of the film is a terrific montage of almost entirely male news anchors through the decades from the 70s to today, declaring it to be politically the year of the woman. With the rest of the film being contemporary footage, I was curious how the idea came up for that montage to open.
Yeah, it's funny. I actually started when I conceived of the idea for the film, there was always going to be a significant amount of archival in it. Mm-hmm. So this was actually a process of having much more archival throughout earlier cuts and having the rest of it get stripped away. But I was always interested in using archival in kind of this lyrical commentary way where we dip in and out of history to create commentary on, like, oh, this is a woman from the 70s who's experiencing some of the same things that we're seeing today, and kind of tie in, again, harking back to that universality that I was trying to get to earlier. Like, there used to be quite a bit of, like, Shirley Chisholm in there, in ways we'd, like, again, kind of just dip in and out of. And it eventually got stripped out over time. It just, the verite stories that we were telling, you know, to be honest, the first cut of the film was 5 hours long.
Wow.
Whoa. I think many other, you know, editors can relate. You have a monstrously sure. long assembly for the first version. But, you know, it does become sort of a process of subtraction as you're figuring out, like, okay, I need clarity. What's the focus? What's mm-hmm. the focus? And the focus always came back to, it's these three women and kind of the intimacy of their present day stories. But I did just always love that archival intro opportunity to kind of frame what we are about to see as, I think especially in the aftermath of 2018, there was a lot of excitement about there's this pink wave, it's this year of the woman, maybe our problems are solved. And I wanted to gently remind people that perhaps not all the problems have been solved. And, yeah. and this is something we still need to pay attention to.
Yeah, It sounds like you went into the film with one idea of it. Was that a scripted idea, or did you just want it to be filmed and then let it evolve in the editing room?
Yeah, I always think I tend to stay pretty far away from scripts as a filmmaker. I think the best stuff comes for me and for this project when I was surprised by something. So I had a lot of kind of preconceived ideas about what I was going into film. And you need those. You need some structure, some sense of, why am I showing up this day to film? What's this event going to be? You know, how is it going to fit into the story? You have to have that direction. But I think it's just as important to stay open-minded to, the possibility that you were completely wrong. And I think that happened a lot across all three stories, especially it's like, it would happen when I'd get to sit down interviews and I'd be asking Bryn, like, you know, isn't it particularly challenging running in a small office or running for office in a small town for this reason? And she'd be like, no, that's not it. Like, you totally missed it. And I'd be like, oh, okay. You know, and Julie is someone that I just loved, you know, off camera as well, talking politics with, because I never quite understood where she was coming from and when. And we share so many similar values, actually, even though I consider myself pretty progressively liberal. Mm-hmm. And yeah, and so we'd get to interview her, we'd be in these scenes, and I'd be like, well, don't you feel this way about the Republican Party doing this thing? And she'd be like, no, that's not the issue. That's not the issue. You're looking in the wrong place. Oh, so I those are the moments that I kind of, love finding in the edit.
And the film makes the back and forth coverage of the three candidates seem seamless. But I'm wondering if you were filming it that way, if you were filming very close together to make these stories happen.
Yeah, it was a grueling production process, I would say, especially as a kind of as a one-woman band. You know, so there were a couple of tricks to it. And one is that both Maya's mayoral election was in, the primary election was in August of 2017. And Bryn's township trustee election was in November of 2017. And Julie's state representative election wasn't until 2018. So there's a bit of trickery in trying to weave all of these pieces together. But I think part of, one of the nice things about that on the production end was I had a little bit of staggered time, breathing room in between these very high intensity periods kind of leading up to election day, which was necessary, again, kind of as a one woman band who's like taking to the road in her trusty Subaru Forester and staying at a lot of roadside motels and like living on a lot of peanut butter and jelly as you're kind of crisscrossing these three states over like 2.5 years of shooting, really. I think I tallied at one point between all of the back and forth. I drove about 30,000 miles. Ooh. Which is longer than the circumference of the earth. If I have my facts right, someone should probably fact check me on that. But
We can all agree it's a lot.
It felt like a lot. Got through a lot of podcasts.
I bet. I really enjoyed it just watching it as a viewer. Like my preconceived notion when I hit play was like, oh, the finale is going to be election night. Mm-hmm. And I loved how it was structured. If you could speak to that a little bit as you're editing, when did you feel like you had the structure in place there where we do get like some election nights are halfway through the film or it's not, to me, it felt like, especially maybe using Brynn as an example, the end goal wasn't just the election. It was then also governing as well. And I really liked that you got to see some governing actually happen too.
Yeah. You know, I always knew that I wanted to follow up for a year after election night. That was important to me. Obviously, I didn't know who was going to win and who was going to lose and what it was going to look like. But I, from early on, I kind of knew that I wanted this to be a really personal telling of a political story. And I wanted to see, you know, what is the personal impact of running for office, even if you do lose? What does that mean to you and to a community that you fight for? So I had kind of signed on. Bryn swears I didn't tell her this in advance, but I think I did. But yeah, I always knew that I wanted to follow for a year afterwards. That being said, it kind of was a challenge because, as you mentioned, most political films, you know how to build that those kind of dramatic stakes up to an election night finale. And in this case, it was building up the stakes once to one set of elections and then figuring out how to rebuild stakes to really a second set of elections at the end of the film. And so in some ways, you know, I watched a lot of political docs for inspiration, but in other ways I needed to turn to kind of other personal story, kind of film and media to help guide how to set those stakes up.
Did you have any particular political docs that you were really inspired by or looking to for inspiration?
Yeah. I mean, I watched just a lot kind of spanning a lot of political decades, but I definitely watched Street Fight a number of times.
Oh yeah.
And watched a lot of the recent ones, you know, loved Knock Down the House and Running with Beto and Wiener even, funnily enough. As I mentioned, I also kind of tried to soak up some more personal docs as well and ended up really drawing a lot, I think, from the film On Her Shoulders, which came out a couple of years ago. And it's just, again, like a very personal story about a female protagonist. And I found some parallels in the way that she talks about or struggles to talk about trauma. And I was trying to figure out how to tell Maya's story. And Maya is someone who has some trauma in her life. And part of her kind of personal arc in the film is figuring out how to reclaim her own narrative and tell that story on her own terms. And so it was really helpful to look to some personal docs for guidance on things like that.
On the note of personal, I'm wondering how you're spending your time these days at this shelter in place era. Have you been binging on anything, food, films, something else?
Yes, of course. funnily enough, I just finally got into The Sopranos, and then I saw an article that was like a bunch of millennials are getting into The Sopranos for the first time. So I'm not even unique in rediscovering The Sopranos at this moment, but that's been kind of my TV binge. I'm sort of embarrassed to admit that my birthday was a week ago, and my boyfriend and I made a whole cake, which then we had to eat entirely by ourselves.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah, so that was like a good and terrible thing. Didn't have to share it with anyone, but did feel sick after a few days.
We did that for my wife's birthday a couple weeks ago as well. We did a cheesecake, and then it was like fun, you know, cooking together, and then we realized it's sweet and sour because you're like, oh, we got to eat this whole thing, which is great because it's delicious, but oh, we got to eat this whole thing.
Oh, it's happening.
Yeah.
Well, I'm so glad we got a chance to get you or maybe after the cake coma is over.
I'm a little bit more lucid today. It's been like a few days. There we go. And, you know, or maybe I'm going through cake withdrawals. I'm not.
Yes. There you go. But I really appreciate you talking with us and really enjoyed the film. It was an eye-opening look at how the person who gets to be your representative in political life gets there or doesn't.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, thank you for having this conversation with me. I'm so glad I could join.
And thanks again. We've been talking with Hillary Bachelder, who was director, cinematographer, and editor for the film Represent. I'm Dee Perry, and my co-host is...
Aaron Spears.
And we thank you for listening to CIFF Speaks.